In this slide, we're going to look at some things that you learned in 1202, Chemistry 1202, and we're going to build on them. One of the things that you learned about in general chemistry is that equilibria have an equilibrium expression like what we see down here. And so if A and B are in equilibrium with C and D, we can write an equilibrium expression. The coefficient, of course, is the power to which it's raised. And then the K equilibrium, the number value for it, that we can determine experimentally, that actually tells us how the equilibrium lies. And it gives us information about what to predict with that reaction. The equilibrium constant is greater than 1, that means the products are the favored reaction. For instance, if the equilibrium constant is 10, that means that the concentration of the products is 10 times that of the reactants. If we have an equilibrium constant that's less than 1, then that means that we have the reactants being favored. So our equilibrium constant gives us a good idea on what position the equilibrium lies. The free energy is what determines which way the reaction is favored. So when you have a K equilibrium that's greater than 1, free energy is negative, and so the forward reaction is favored. If it turns out that your equilibrium constant is less than 1, it's because the free energy is positive moving forward, and it's not favored to go forward. And we call these exergonic and endergonic reactions. Usually, though, we revert to enthalpy of reaction, and we talk about exothermic and endothermic reactions. Sometimes we realize that endothermic reactions go ahead because there is entropy favoring the endothermic reaction. And sometimes exothermic reactions don't go forward because the entropy does not favor the reaction. And so we have to go back to the free energy change to actually understand what's happening. But we still tend to talk mostly about exothermic and endothermic reactions. Bond dissociation energies are basically the energy that it takes to take a bond and change it into two free radicals. These bond dissociation energies are often used with regards to explaining why reactions occur a certain way. Realize that the higher the bond, the dissociation energy that there is the harder it is to break that bond. So a really strong bond has a high bond dissociation energy, and it does not want to break apart easily. A strong bond has a very low energy. A weak bond has a very high energy. Try to remember that, because that gets students confused. They always think high in energy, it must be strong, but it's actually the opposite way. So strong bonds have very low energy, so electrons want to flow down to them and get in the low energy place, so they're very stable. Weak bonds have high energy. The electrons want to get out of them because they're high energy and they want to flow to a low energy place. So let's look at reaction profiles or energy diagrams. If I look at just a one-step reaction, going up to the transition state where bonds are broken and new bonds have not yet formed, and then down to another lower state, what we are looking at is the change in energy as the bonds break, and then the change in energy as new bonds form. Okay, the activation energy, the distance up to the top, is what determines how fast the reaction goes. So if we have a really high activation energy, it's going to be a very slow reaction. Whereas if we have a very low activation energy, then it should be a fast reaction. Okay, so this activation energy is what determines the speed of the reaction. It is not the distance between the reactant and the product of the step. It is only the transition state that determines the bond, the speed of the reaction. This is an intermediate state, this is a carbocation formation right here. So right here, this is an intermediate state. It's high in energy, but it's nowhere near as high as the transition state energy. Okay, what this is showing is the rest of a particular reaction. The reaction we're looking at is one that we've seen before. We have ethylene reaching out and grabbing a proton off hydrobromic acid, and then the electrons making bromide. So that is this step right here to the carbocation intermediate. Notice we put brackets around the carbocation because it's an intermediate. It is not something you can bottle up and take away. It's ephemeral. It lasts for only a brief moment, sometimes nanoseconds, and then it reacts. So here we have bonds being broken to the transition state, new bonds being formed to an intermediate state that's high energy still, and then bonds being broken again to a second transition state, and then dropping down to the product formed. This is an exothermic reaction. It is exergonic also because we see delta G. Here is what it is. You would find that it was exothermic also. If I look at the activation energies, the activation energy for the first step is very high. The activation energy for the second step is very low. So this is the slower step, that's the faster step. So what actually happens is this slowly occurs, and then as soon as it occurs, bam, that forms really quickly. We call this the rate limiting step because it's slow. The rate limiting step always has the larger activation energy. Here's a picture of the transition state for hydrobromic acid addition. If you look at this, you would see this is the pi bond right here, and it's in the middle of being broken. Here is the bond from carbon to hydrogen. It's in the middle of being formed. Here is the bond between hydrogen and bromide. It's in the middle of being broken. So in a transition state is the highest energy possible, and there you have the most bonds broken without any new bonds being fully formed. They're beginning to form. So transition state is intermediate between here and here. This is an intermediate. It's this little resting state that reacts quickly due to a small activation energy to form the product. Each activation energy, and I'm calling it a little hump here to show you, that is one step in the reaction. So if I look at this particular reaction profile, I would see there is one activation energy, two activation energies, three activation energies. So this particular reaction has three steps in its mechanism. Here's intermediate energy, high energy, very low energy. So what is the rate limiting step here? The rate limiting step is from B to the top of this hump, the largest energy that's possible of the three, largest energy choice. So this right here is a rate limiting step. It has nothing to do with how high it gets up here. What it has to do is the distance from one place to the very, very top. Okay, there is a reverse reaction here too. Notice we can go D to C, C to B, and B to A. For the reverse reaction, if I look, D to C has more energy required, or equivalent energy, it looks like slightly more to me, energy required than to go from C up to the top here. So if I look at the reverse reaction, I would say D to C is the rate limiting step, and then C to B and B to A occur a little bit more quickly. Okay, so here's the slide where we actually talk about this. One thing that it says here is since B to C activation energy is higher, that's more than any of these. That means it's going to be a reversible reaction. If it goes forward, if there's enough energy to make it go forward, there's enough energy to make it go back because B to here is bigger than this to this or this to this. And so if it's a reversible reaction, what's going to determine which side is favored? Well, A will be favored because it's lower in energy than D. Okay, so that's how equilibria occur, is that the activation energy for the reverse is no bigger, or it can easily be surmounted at the energies that we typically encounter compared to the forward reaction. So both the forward reaction and the reverse reaction occur. If instead I had where D was way down here in energy, that first step activation energy would be really high, and it would be much greater than from B up here. So if this was way down low, well then the reaction would probably not be reversible. Okay, now what follows are a bunch of U-triads that have to do with this entire chapter 6. So what we're going to do is we're going to go through these slowly and try each of these problems. For each one, as soon as you get to the problem, go ahead and pause, figure it out, and then check your answer by restarting the lecture. Okay, what you're going to do here is identify which of these compounds would give a single monochlorination product. Well, if I look at each of these compounds, I would see this right here has only one type of carbon, only one type of hydrogen. This would give a single monochlorination product. However, if I look at this, propane has two different types of carbons and two different types of hydrogens. So this would give two products. If I look at cyclohexane, you would find all of these carbons are identical to each other, and the hydrogens are all identical to each other. So if I do monochloration of this, I would just get chlorocyclohexane. All the carbons are the same. If I look at this compound, I would see there are three carbons that are primary and attached to tertiary carbon. There is one carbon that is primary and attached to a secondary carbon, and then there's a secondary carbon. Of course, the quaternary carbon right here cannot react and be chlorinated. So what would we get? We would get 1, 2, 3 different products here. If I look at this molecule and I do monochlorination, I would have only one product because this carbon is identical to this, and so the hydrogens are identical also. If I look at this molecule, all of these carbons have no hydrogens on them. So the only hydrogens are the ones on the outside and the ones that could be replaced by chlorination. So this would give only one product since all the methyl groups are the same as each other. So A, C, E, and F all give one product. Determined for this, in this free radical reaction, think through the mechanism and identify for what step would light be required. Think through what are the three steps and which one requires light. If I look at this and this reaction occurs, what happens is light would break the bond in the chlorine. That is an initiation reaction. And so that is the mechanism step that requires the light. The rest of them are propagation and termination, and they occur whether or not there's light. They just continue the reaction or terminate the reaction. How many monohalogenation products are possible for this compound? And it says, do not consider stereoisomers because you would get some chiral compounds that could occur. So don't worry about the chiral compounds. Any enantiomers would be considered one product. Okay, if I look at this compound right here, I would see there is 1, 2, 3, 4 different types of carbons. Each one of these carbons has hydrogens on it. One, there are three here, one here, two here, and two here. So there are 4 different products possible. So which product would be formed in greatest abundance? If I look at this molecule, I would see there's a primary, a secondary, and a tertiary. The tertiary carbon forms the most stable free radical, so the product that forms is in greatest abundance is the chlorine, the halogen, being put onto the tertiary carbon. Which of these properly describes what happens in a free radical bromination of 2-methylpropane? The initiation step does not cleave a carbon-hydrogen bond. What actually happens is the bromine is cleaved by the free light and it forms 2 free radicals. So that's the initiation step. The free radical reacts with bromine. This actually can happen. Once a free radical forms, it can bump into some bromines. So this looks like it's a good possibility, but let's eliminate the others before we claim that this is it. One step is a homolytic cleavage of a carbon-bromine bond. No, the only homolytic cleavage that you have of any bonds is going to be of the bromine cleaving homolytically. The reaction occurs in a single step. Well, we've seen that there's initiation, propagation, and then termination, so it's not a single step. So the only statement that makes sense is this one. An alkane with this molecular formula reacts with chlorine to give a single monochloride. What is the most reasonable structure? If I go ahead and figure this out and then we'll restart. If I look at this formula, I can see 2 times 8 is 16, so this must not have a ring. That's the first thing I noticed about this. So it has to be an open chain, and that's the only things that are possible. If I look at this alkane, I would have 1, 2, 3, 4 different products because there are 4 different types of carbons. Notice this carbon and this carbon are the same. This one and this one are the same. This one and this one are the same. And that one are the same. But 4 different products. If I look at this, there would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 different products. Okay? That's, you're not going to get a single product. You're going to get a mixture. Likewise, if I look at this, there's 1, 2, 3 different carbons, so 3 different products. If I look at this molecule, however, each methyl is the same as the other. So this one is going to give us a monochlorination product. What is the mechanism for the formation of this bromide from this alkene? Go ahead, write the mechanism using arrows. The first step is the alkene reaches out and grabs a proton after the hydrogen off the hydrogen bromide. Then the electrons that are in the hydrogen bromide bond jump onto the bromine. The bromine then dives into the carbocation that forms, and we get this bromide. Okay, use this energy profile here to and determine what is the highest energy intermediate. Well, position number one is a reactant. It's not an intermediate, so I can eliminate that. Position number two is an intermediate. Excuse me, is not an intermediate. It's a transition state, my error. So it is not an intermediate. If I look at position number four, I would see that it also is a transition state. And if I look at position number five, that's the product. The only thing that is an intermediate is three, and it's the highest energy intermediate and the lowest energy intermediate. So this is correct
answer. So which part of this energy diagram here indicates whether the overall reaction is exergonic or endergonic? Or if we were plotting enthalpy, exothermic or endothermic? Well, if I look at this chart, I can see that 2 is an activation energy, 3 is the energy of the intermediate, and 4 is an activation energy, and even 5 is the activation energy for this reverse step. So 2 is the activation energy for the first step in this reaction. 4 is not really any kind of energy. The energy difference between the second transition state and the reagents. Right here, 5 is the activation energy for the reverse first step. The only thing that makes sense for the overall reaction is from the reactant to the product. Which of the following statements is true?
All right. Well, if I look at this statement right here, transition states can be observed and sometimes isolated. That is absolutely not true. They cannot really be observed and they can't be isolated. The only thing we can do is infer them from evidence in the reaction. Intermediates can be observed and sometimes isolated. They can be observed. We can detect them, but they're ephemeral. And so we can never isolate them. Intermediates can never be observed. No, we can't observe intermediates by spectroscopy. Spectroscopy is fast enough in observation that we can detect them being there, but we can never isolate them. So the true statement is right here. But if you look at this one, transition states cannot be observed and never isolated. This is also true. So there are really two true statements here. Which of the following represents a correctly drawn mechanism? Okay, let's look at the first one here. We show electrons going in to form a bond on this carbon. If I look over here, this carbon is this carbon, and this carbon is this carbon. So yes, you do see that bond form, but this is showing this carbon-carbon bond breaking. That is not broken, so this cannot be. Likewise, the same thing here. There are two errors in this, though. Not only is this carbon-carbon bond not breaking, but it's showing that this is forming this. That's the loss of a hydrogen there and a positive charge from this. So this mechanism here is not possible. Right here, we're showing electrons leaving a positive charge. Oh, is that wrong? You never have something, an electrophile, give up its electrons. It's always the nucleophile goes towards the positive charge. Okay, if I look at this reaction down here, electrons reaching out to form a bond here. Well, that actually does occur.
electrons going from this bond onto the bromine, well, it does lose its positive charge, and that bond does break. But the problem is, look, there's two hydrogens on the oxygen, overall positive charge, only one hydrogen on the oxygen, and you've lost that positive charge, so this must be incorrect. If I look at this reaction, charge is conserved, positive, positive, and if you look, bond forming, bond formed, bond breaking, electrons here neutralizing that charge, giving neutral here, electrons leaving oxygen, getting a positive charge on that oxygen. So, here is a reason this is wrong. Here is a reason this is wrong. Here is a reason that this is wrong. And here is a reason that this is wrong. The most important thing is that this one is right. So what kind of reaction is shown in the transformation below? If I look at this reaction, let me get a pointer here. If I look at the reaction here, you can see there is a chlorine added here. There are two hydrogens on this carbon. There are now three hydrogens on this carbon. If I look at what happened here, we lost this double bond and we gained a bond to the chlorine, and we gained a hydrogen onto this, and we gained a hydrogen over here. We gained a hydrogen added here so that there's three here. This is not a substitution. It's not a rearrangement. And nothing's being eliminated. The only thing that is possible here is that this is
consider this reaction profile.
If you have enough heat in the reaction to cause the largest activation energy to be have enough energy present for the largest activation energy to occur, and there's time for all these molecules to equilibrate, what would be the main structure present, the main reagent present at after equilibrium occurs? Well, if I look at this, you will see there's enough energy to overcome this, and of course over this, since this is the slow step right here, the fast step would occur. This is the slow step for the reverse, that one would occur. All these, it's going to be going back and forth and back and forth. Of course, these are transition states, so they never accumulate. That's an intermediate. It never accumulates. The only thing that can accumulate is E and A. A is lower energy, so A would be what accumulates. So with time, the lowest energy compound will form if there's enough energy to undergo both the forward and the reverse reaction. Which energy difference here corresponds to the activation energy for the rate-limiting step? Okay, if I look at these, the way this is given is the first one subtracting the second one is energy difference. So if I look at D minus C, that would be D minus C. So this would be the energy difference, that height right there. That's a very tiny energy difference. And so going from C to D would occur very quickly, so it cannot be the rate limiting step. E minus A, well, that's the difference between the reagent and the product. So this cannot be an activation energy. That would be the energy difference between the product and the reagent, and so the energy difference for the reverse reaction. If I look at D minus A, that would be the difference in energy from here up to here. That doesn't represent anything that we look at. That's not a transition. It's a transition state for the second step, but it's not an activation energy for anything. C minus A, well, that's the energy difference between the intermediate and A, but that's not the activation energy. The activation energy for the slow step would be going from A to B. So B minus A represents the activation energy for the slow step, the rate limiting step. Which of these statements is incorrect? Well, let's work through each statement to find out which one is incorrect. Okay, if I look, electrophiles can be neutral as well as positive. We have seen that that is true. Lewis bases generally behave as nucleophiles. Well, that's true because Lewis bases have a non-bonding pair. They can be nucleophiles. Polar reactions occur between electrophiles and nucleophiles. Well, of course, we're looking at electrons being attracted to protons, so it's a polar reaction. Initiation in a free radical reaction must generate unpaired electrons. Well, we have seen that's exactly the definition of an initiation step, is that a bond breaks homolytically to make two free radicals, which are two unpaired electrons. And then here, polar reactions must have ionic intermediates. This is incorrect. We see polar reactions having no intermediates. We see polar reactions having only neutral intermediates. So this statement is incorrect. Okay, in this reaction, what is the role of the alkene? Which of these here is the role that it plays in this reaction? If I look at this reaction, you can see that the alkene here is going to be grabbing the proton, so it must be using its pi bond to grab that proton. That pi bond is a nucleophile. So the role is as
go ahead and draw in the arrows for this reaction to occur.
If I draw in the arrows for this, what's going to happen is this pi bond is going to grab a proton. This is a nucleophile, and the proton on this hydronium ion is the electrophile. So those electrons reach out and grab that proton. The hydrogen cannot have two bonds. So the electrons must leave that bond to become the non-bonding pair on the oxygen. In a free radical reaction, how do I describe this particular step? Well, because you're taking two free radicals and joining them together, it cannot be initiation. The reverse of this would be initiation. It is not elimination because that is not a step in a free radical reaction. And it is not substitution because it is not a step in a free radical reaction. If I look, two free radicals are joining together and there are no free radicals afterwards. The only thing that makes sense for this is termination, since in propagation you have a free radical beforehand and a free radical afterwards. And so it is termination. So, which of these does not describe the role that can be played by an enzyme in a biological reaction? Well, you really had to have read the book to figure this out, but you might have been able to figure it out by just logic. In a reaction is not the beginning energy and the ending energy of a reaction is not changed by a catalyst, which an enzyme is. The only thing that a catalyst does is it lowers the energy of a transition state. And it may do that by changing the mechanism. If it lowers the energy of a transition state, it will change the rate of the reaction. It can also change the specificity of a reaction to make sure it only occurs from one side to the other. But it cannot change the energy of the reactant nor the energy of the product. So the only thing that does not describe what an enzyme does is changing the free energy of the reaction. Which of the following here would be the worst nucleophile? Okay, for you to figure this one out, you have to think about which one has no electrons to give out and reach out to form a bond. Ammonia has a non-bonding pair on the nitrogen. Water has a non-bonding pair on the oxygen. Ethylene has a pi bond that can act as a nucleophile. and phosphorus is like nitrogen, and it has a non-bonding pair on the phosphorus. The only thing that will not act as a nucleophile is borane. It is a Lewis acid, and it has no pair of electrons to be attracted to a positive charge. All it has, the only electrons it has are in bonds, and they're used up, can't be available to react as a nucleophile. What type of reaction is this one? So if I look at this reaction, okay, the first thing is, I know it's not a free radical reaction, so it cannot be a termination step. It is not a heterolytic process because lytic says bond break or cut, and you're actually putting together. It is not an initiation step because it's not making free radicals. And it's not a homogenic process. Homo means same, and you see two different things here. The only thing this can be an example of is an exergonic reaction. And that actually makes a lot of sense. High energy, combining together to make a neutral compound. It must be a drop in energy.
Okay, in the reaction of chlorine with 2-methylbutane, how many monochlorinated isomers are produced?
Well, to do this reaction, you have to look and see how many different carbons there are. We see one right here. Those two are one. So this and this are the same. Two would be right here, this tertiary carbon. Three would be the secondary carbon. And then this primary carbon is different from those two, so it would give you four different hydrogens or four different carbons. So that would give us four products. Which one would be most likely to be chlorinated? Because this would be formed by a tertiary free radical, chlorination would occur on this carbon.